How you doing? Welcome to Zicky Dice's Outlandish Paradise, presented by Twitch here on the front page of Twitch. We've got a good show planned here for you today. The warlord of weird, Sinn Bodhi, is coming to hang out with us on the stream. You might know him as Kazarni from WWE. He's pretty involved in the professional wrestling world, and he's going to tell us all about it. So get your questions ready, and let me tell you this. He's a little weird. So weird that his mic cuts in and out. Believe me. Baby girl, you stay subbed all the time, fulfill my fantasies. You know you love to watch ZDTV. In case you missed it last night, I painted Effie's jacket. You see that, chat? If you've got heartburn, it's time to party. Anyone out there? You know, fanny pack's been missing. We printed the missing posters all over the stream. If you've seen my fanny pack, please bring it back to Outlandish Zicky Dice. I'm about to give birth to the hottest free agent in all of entertainment. Outlandish Zicky Dice. Hashtag sign Zicky Dice here in the chat today. If they're not going to open the door for us, hell, we're going to open it ourselves. Fanny pack! Fanny pack! Whoa, wait!
Here, I'm here!
No!
I'm here!
Fanny pack!
In here! I've been stuck in the snow!
You're stuck in the snow? You sound like you're muted and we're underwater!
What?
It sounded like you were muted and underwater!
Oh, I don't know.
They said they miss you so much, Fanny Pack. I miss you. Tell us all about your journey.
Horrible. Oh, no power and no water with the good people in Texas, but that's why I came back to the paradise. It's time for Fanny Pack's top 5 botched clips of the week. My favorite part!
Oh yeah!
Roll up!
I was going to be on there this week after my weekend in Idaho.
Oh, you botched it?
Oh, we always do. We always do. Fanny, are you there?
I'm here. Go to eatcleanbro.com and tell them Fanny Pack sent you.
Outlandish. This is the bread and butter. It's all we got. This is all we got left. I love every single one of you very much from the bottom of my fanny pack. I'll tell you that. That's a good one. From the bottom of my fanny pack. We got to remember that one. That needs to be a bumper sticker. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome the warlord of weird, Sinn Bodhi.
3 months of being outlandish.
Yes. Hello, Sin. Welcome to this paradise.
I'm enjoying that I'm coming at you from hot dogs and handshake carts.
You know how we do. You know how we do here at the paradise. We get weird.
I understand. Oh, I get it. I'm picking up what you put down.
You know, sometimes you got it. Welcome to the front page of Twitch, my favorite purple platform, the only purple platform where you can catch Outlandish Zicky Dice. I'm happy to have you here. If I would have known, if I would have prepared, I would have booked you for some entertainment here at the Paradise. We've got a nice little tent set up behind the poop loop there, and we've got nice crowds.
I understand. I'm trying to get where I can see you. Sorry to be...
No, don't be. You look great.
My technology is not entirely amazing. I am fairly slick when you surround me by ropes and turnbuckles, but in real life, especially in front of the computer, maybe not so slick.
I feel you there. I got to say, a lot of people for the first time, I'm going to be honest, they don't know who I am and they don't know who you are. Why don't you start and tell us who you are?
Fair enough. My name is Sinn Bodhi. I wrestle as the Warlord of Weird. I'm going into my 22nd year of pro wrestling. I've been a martial artist for 38 years. I was trained originally by Ron Hutchinson, the same cat that trained Edge of Christian. I actually grew up with Edge of Christian. I trained in the same class as Trish Stratus and Gail Kim. They were both way tougher than anybody else in that class, by the way. They hit the road. I started wrestling all over the place, wherever I could get my hands on a wrestling show. And over the years, I've wrestled as part of the New Church at TNA. I was Kazarni on WWE SmackDown. And in between, before Medium and after all that jazz, I'm one of those guys that have wrestled more of the 80s dudes combined than a lot of people, that a lot of locker rooms put together. So I carry around a lot of those tricks of the trade. And I spent a lot of time learning under Al Snow, Dusty Rhodes, Rip Rogers, Dr. Tom, and my mentor, Jake the Snake. So when I was growing up, Jake was my idol. Then he became my opponent. Then he came by my mentor and to this day, one of my best pals. So I think I'm right now I do a lot of wrestling and coaching. So yes. I think a lot of what I'm spewing in my wrestling seminars or when I'm player coaching or whatever, a lot of that stuff is Jake Roberts-isms or Dusty-isms or Dr. Yes. Thomas. And then there's a few me-isms in there too. But I think, so there you go. And I coach regularly online with the Snake Pit. So yes. I think... Here's my elevator pitch. So now you know what I am, and obviously I'm good looking. So there you have it.
I love that. I'm not going to lie. I was watching some of the Snake Pit before the stream, and you had mentioned the guy had him by the stomach. What was that stomach move called? And you said, I teach Zicky this one. What was that? That move looks sick.
The tummy claw.
The tummy Zicky claw.
Anytime you want to play tummy sticks, my man, I'm good to go.
We have to follow terms of service, but I'm sure you've got at least one good, exciting story that you've seen with your own two eyes that maybe you can share with us here at the Paradise. One of your favorite professional wrestling little stories?
Oh, boy. I could tell you a million. Let me just dump into my brain and just pull out a random group of brain cells and see what I can come up with. So one night, wrestling on SmackDown... in my Kazarni phase of my career, I would ride a lot with Edge. And so this story is weird where it's like, it's a fragment of a story because it doesn't have a definitive ending. I don't know. and again, when I'm the weird one and I'm sort of like, if I'm befuddled, that should really scare the average bear. So one night, I'm going to bunk up with Edge. My flight is different from his flight. I'm getting in later. And since I was a developmental guy for FCW, they would give us comp hotel rooms where the contract, the main contract guys would get, they'd have to pay for that themselves. Mm-hmm. So just to be cool, I'm like, well, hey, man, you know, I would crash with Edge or Edge would crash with me or whatever. Mostly I would crash with Edge. He would afford the big fancy hotel rooms that I couldn't afford. He's like, I'll just shut up and you can stay with me. So he was always a very cool, generous friend like that. But so one night I had the freebie hotel room. So I said, look, my flight is going to be late. Just I'll call up to the desk and just say, hey, put Adam Edge's name on the deal. Go into the room. I'll see you there. So, okay. So as I get to this hotel room, I'm about to slide the key through the door. And all of a sudden the hotel door bursting open, and I just see Hornswoggle get punted out of my hotel room, and he's wearing just a pair of tighty-whities. and Edge had kicked Hornswoggle out of the hotel room, and Edge is wearing nothing but Hornswoggle's pants, which look like some kind of ridiculous capris or something, like these like knee-high pants on. Like, Edge is like about 6'5". Hornswoggle is not. So just imagine Edge squeezing into Hornswoggle's pants, okay? Because he's like, he's yelling at Hornswoggle, "Get out of here, you filthy little blah, 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 blah," and all this stuff. And Hornswoggle just turned to him, kind of looking like some kind of little Schmeagle or something, like, and he rolled away and kind of buzzed off. And then I see, and then Edge looks at me like very nonchalantly, like, "Oh, hey, man." And then he walks back into the room. And I'm just standing there with like holding my rolly bag and all the stuff, like, the F is going on. And then Matt Stryker comes walking out with his head held down in shame, looks at me and just kind of is like, you know, he's got the sorry look on his eyes. And then Tommy Dreamer walks out of my room with the exact same look, like, "Oh, hey." And he's kind of like, looks really like shy or upset or something. Like, it looked really ridiculous. And then, so I went into the room and I'm like, I didn't even want to ask. I'm just like, "What is going on here?" And he's like, "Yeah, sometimes you got to kick out a leprechaun, you know, when they miss the toilet and all this stuff." So apparently Hornswoggle had done some pretty crappy business, pardon the pun, in my hotel room bathroom. And oh. So there he goes. Just like, all right, I guess another day on planet Earth. So I just, you know, threw my rolly bag down and went to sleep, and that was that. And so there's no rhyme or reason to this story except how wrestling is so playfully insane. You cannot describe it or get a beat on it, because how can you equate insanity? Wrestling is purely insane. There's no sanity. There's no way to gauge or wonder or speculate, because wrestling is always going to zig when you expect it to zag, and there you go.
All right, I got to ask. You got some tanks behind you. What's in there? You got any lizards?
So me and my wife do animal rescue stuff. Humans and animals, yep, all day.
Love that.
So we have in the tank, there's two tanks behind me, two giant aquariums, and in each tank is a giant red-tailed boa, which Jake the Snake would often use in his matches. I'm his snake guy, amongst other things. But so yeah, sitting behind me are two 8-foot long giant ass snakes. And they're ridiculous. And every critter that lives in this house, including myself and my kid and my wife, are all ridiculous creatures. I think it's part of being in this house. And so we have two giant snakes behind me. I have two crazy, ridiculous chickens in the front. I have a giant 150-pound tortoise in the backyard. I have maybe a 20-pound tortoise that just walks around the house. Like, she uses the doggy door and eats with the dogs and hangs out with the cats. And then there's a little old me. And so I think I named about everybody. There's a whole political system here between the dogs and the cats, by the way. There's a full hierarchy, and it's ridiculous. And there you go.
I love that. That's wild.
Has like bedrooms after bathrooms after bedrooms after bathrooms, and it was dirt cheap. And so we're trying to like wonder, like, the worker in me, the wrestler in me is like, why is this place so cheap? So I guess apparently, like, in real estate, when something bad happens at a property, it very, very, very much decreases the value. Nobody else wants to buy or rent it.
Oh, no.
So I realized what we had stumbled onto was the Warren Jeffs sex polygamy Mormon compound, cult compound. Who, that dude is in jail for life for all of what I just mentioned.
Uh-huh.
And except for being a Mormon, but everything else is pretty gnarly. And so I live, basically, me and my wife and my kid and my critters all live at the former Warren Jeffs sex cult compound.
Holy. You know, someone in the chat asked, they said, how did you come up with the Warlord of Weird? And I think you just answered that. I think everything you just said, that's just, it all comes together, you know? And that's right. Newfie 420 says, you can't make this up. This is real life, Sin. Speaking of face paint and clowns, are you down with the clown? Insane Clown Posse? Question mark.
Yeah, I'm cool. I'm cool with the Insane Clown Posse. I met them when we worked together. We didn't work together, but we hung together when we met at TNA back 100 years ago. And we've always been cool, and we've always tried to work together. We just, our schedules never, ever, ever gelled up. I worked for them one time when they came into Vegas, and they basically used the venue that I was using on the regular to do freak show wrestling. So we helped them organize a show like through that venue, and I wrestled on that venue against one of their dudes, Chewy Martinez, which was fun. But otherwise, I haven't. I've been in good standing with them. I've known them forever. We've just never really done business together.
Well, never say never. In your entire career, who has been one of your favorite opponents? Thanks for the question, Nate. Nate of Dynamite 21.
Nate, great question. So I've had a ton of amazing opponents. I mean, I could just go on and on and on. And my wife calls me Chatty Cathy, so I might just go on and on and on.
But we love that. So
Zicky Dice's show isn't 5 billion hours long.
No, we love it. Trust me. Keep it going.
I would say off the top of my head, out of all the wonderful performers I've been in the ring with and for different reasons, I would have to go with Gangrel. He was always just a super cool dude to me. I met him before I ever even took a bump in a wrestling ring when I was still like a bodyguard and a bouncer and all that stuff. I was producing a comic book. Like, I'm an artsy-fartsy guy, and I could draw and do tattoos and all that jazz, sculpt and all this. And so I did this ridiculous comic book called Fred the Possessed Flower, just like in the late 90s. And I was literally at a comic convention across the street from a wrestling show that the Brood was wrestling at, the WWF show. And so afterwards, after they were done wrestling, Edge and Christian, Adam and Jay came over to visit me because I was still at the comic convention selling my comics. Mm-hmm. And I had never met Gangrel yet, but just because he knew that I was tight with Edge and Christian, like, you know, friend of a friend is a friend. So like, my brother's brother is my brother. And he literally grabbed a handful of these books and just walked around with his fangs and white puffy shirt and was like, buy this book. This is a really cool book. I think for years he called me Fred because the comic book was called Fred the Possessed Flower. So, and then when I started wrestling, he was always supportive. He was always cool. And I ended up wrestling against him and tagging with him tons and tons of times over the years. And he's always just been fun in the locker room. Just a really, just a great dude. I think there's I don't know if it's like an exact saying or anything, but there is a thing in the wrestling locker rooms across the land that if you don't like Gangrel, you must be a dick.
Yep.
He's such a nice, passionate dude. And I think I'm a pretty nice dude, but I think I'm a total shithead when it comes comparing me next to Gangrel. He is just a sweet guy, giving, caring, passionate, and man, and when you get him in the ring, whew, that's a 280-pound human pit bull with fangs. So I think we're a really fun opponent.
Oh yeah, good question. Thank you for that.
I'm trying to get into the middle of your hot dog stand. That doesn't sound right at all.
But, it's smashing between that hot dog there.
I can see that I'm kind of on a slight delay, so I'm moving one way. I'm thinking, okay, I'm moving the right way, and then all of a sudden it delays me and it sends me. Oh, I was moving the exact opposite of the right way. Oh, dude, I think my life is that Mickey Rourke wrestler movie where, you know, I've wrestled in tiny little Elks lodges, and I've wrestled in giant stadiums and everything in between. And you take the ups and the downs and the good and the bad, and you just try to find your fun, how you can have your fun and learn from everything. I mean, you can learn on some little, you know, dinky little show with some kind of crappy wrestler. You can learn a lot of what not to do and or how to lead the unleadable or whatever. And there's plenty of things to learn in any situation. And again, I think I am thoroughly, as D'Lo Brown would say, I'm a career criminal. I'm thoroughly addicted to this, and I'm going to do this until the wheels fall off. So whether it's at a lodge or a stadium or anywhere in between, I'm ready to go. And if it's in the Pacific Northwest, I'm ready. When they're ready, I'm ready.
You're right about that. And I think, Slit, that might answer your question, but would you ever join or face off against Melvin Troy's MWO?
The short answer, yes.
Yep. I knew you'd say that. I got to get the question in. Sinn, what was one of your favorite cities to wrestle in?
One of my favorite cities to wrestle in? I would say, off the top of my head, Memphis.
Oh.
Memphis, because when I used to wrestle there quite often, sort of right around that New Church time and a little bit after that. And Memphis. It has a lot of very like God-fearing, good folk there.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very blue-collar, hardworking, urban, God-fearing people. So they're just super hardworking, sweet, nice. So when I was dressed up, not like a clown, but there is sort of new church, like in the devil-y stuff. And I was wearing very like almost a feminine devil stuff. Like I'd have the eyeliner on and I had the long, pretty hair. I was good looking back in the day. I used to look
I believe it. I still see it.
Yeah. I used to look like Jack Sparrow. Now I look like Doink the Clown made sweet love to George Steele. So I don't know, the years haven't been kind. But so back in the day, I again had the eyeliner and the long hair and the devil-y stuff. So I think I was sort of a double whammy no-no in the good old South, where like all the urban blue-collar hardworking folks did not want to see a fruity devil, you know, get over. Like I was heat, all kinds of heat. So I remember walking down the aisle to the in the Memphis Coliseum, like where Andy Kaufman and Lawler, S. Rick Flair, Andre the Giant, you name it. We're in this exact ring in this exact building, and your name is put on this giant kind of hockey board up above the ring. And so in my brains, I remember marking out going, this is amazing. And I had this big red fur new church coat on and the big, I had all the devil-y stuff. And I had this giant kind of Kamala-esque devil mask, about a 3-4 foot devil mask with these giant horns. And I came swinging out and I screamed, barked, yelled, whatever you want to say, and swung this mask at the audience. And they kind of toppled over and it made the rest of the audience kind of giggle. And they just all started yelling at me. They were so mad.
And the
crowds in Memphis were always insane. It was like that too in Puerto Rico, like being like a crazy, devil-y, circus-y weirdo was, I mean, the fans there are freaking nuts.
I want to wrestle in Puerto Rico so, so bad.
I've never met Cass. I did meet Enzo at a show in Texas a few months ago.
I love Enzo.
Which was super amazing. I'm like, yes. This dude is very entertaining.
Yeah, oh yeah.
I remember he was walking around a locker room and you know, he's in that mode. You know, that's him. You can't turn that shit off. There's no off button on that dude. Like, that's the dude.
Yep.
And so I remember he's talking to this guy and that guy and he's being nice and complimentary and whatever. And then he sees me and we never met and I don't expect him or anybody else to know who I am. So I'm walking around in his clown thing and he's like, hey, Hughes. Hey man, that makeup looks good. Like you must know what you're doing to have that makeup look so good. And he's like, how long you been doing this, kid? And I'm like, 22 years, young man.
And young man.
I can tell, you know, I can see an experience in the makeup and all the stuff. And he watched me wrestle and he goes, holy crap, yeah, you've been wrestling for a long time. I can see how you move. You really know how to move around in there and all this stuff. And I'm like, hey, thanks. Thanks, Enzo. I also am real. So there you go. I wanted to have, and especially being mentored by Jake, I wanted to have something that was a cousin move to a DDT, but not quite just exactly a DDT. I want to do something a little bit different, but still give him the homage of it being a DDT. So my finish is a double butterfly DDT. And I kind of hook it a little bit different than some of the guys like a Drew McIntyre or a John Moxley. I do it a little bit different, or Mankind. Just try to keep it always a little bit different. So I wanted to have a name that meant something to me. So here's where the story gets a little bit more. I wanted to name it after my deceased sister, my legitimate deceased sister. Between me and my little brother, my mom miscarried who would have been Sarah. And I first thought to call the move Goodnight, Sweet Sarah. But then I thought, man, if my mom hears that, she's going to be really upset and I don't need it.
Yeah.
So I fictionalized who was to be really Sarah. I fictionalized that with the dumbest name I could think of, which is Bruce Willis's kid's name, Tallulah Bell. So long story short, Tallulah Bell is the fictional name of my legitimate dead sister. And I remember using Tallulah Bell on FCW and like Dusty Rhodes be commentating like, you know, hearing Dusty Rhodes say the name Tallulah Bell is still ridiculous to me. Like, I thought it was so weird. And a young Bray Wyatt. He wasn't Bray Wyatt yet. He was still, I think, Husky Harris. He might have still been Wyndham Rotunda even. And he would always ask me questions like, hey, why do you do this? Why do you do that? And I wanted to facilitate answers to those passionate questions because I wanted answers to when I was asking questions.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Other wrestlers, and I never believed in hoarding knowledge. I want to share knowledge. So, Bray Wyatt would ask me like, why do you call that Tallulah Bell? And I said, I named it for my dead sister. And he went, why would you do that? And I said, well, when I hit my opponent with that, just like her, they ain't getting up. And he was just like, oh man, that's really stiff. That's crazy. And then when I got canned, Abigail.
There it is. There it is.
And to put a little, a nice spin on the end of that, I am good friends with Bray Wyatt. I am very proud of Bray Wyatt. And I'm very happy that he took any bits of inspiration. I'm very happy if he did or didn't, however that all plays out, I'm happy for him. And zero bitterness in this story, and just letting you know of how the cookie crumbled.
That's right. I love that. Okay. I tried to get this one in earlier, and I love it. Tell us about your collection of figures behind you. What do you got there?
So those are LJNs, and they're customized LJNs. So LJNs, for people who don't know, they're like the very first line of toys WWF made in the 80s. So when I was a little kid, I collected these things. Me and Edge and Christian collected these things together, and we would write cards and put guys over and who's going to do the job. And we didn't speak in those terms. We didn't understand those terms just yet, but we were literally learning how to wrestle, interlinking the little, because these guys aren't like articulated figures. These guys are like rubber chew toys. Mm-hmm. Like these things, you could pistol whip somebody. We're pretty good with these things. Hardly weapons in the making. And so sometimes we would put over the guys we didn't necessarily like just because they maybe had cooler poses. Excuse me, I'm coffee burping than you guys. I apologize.
That's all right.
And so we just loved those toys as kids. And then years later, I lost my collection. It got stolen out of my parents' garage. What kind of monster steals a man's toys?
Terrible. What? Terrible.
And so years later, I recollected them, and I collected full set, the hardest to find ones. There's these things like range in price from $10 to $1,500 per each one, depending on which ones they are. And so I had this whole set, and then when the pandemic happened, and in that first 2 weeks, everybody's like, oh, we're gonna lock down for 2 weeks, and the worker in me just knew, like, hey, I'm smart enough to know I don't know much, but I know they ain't gonna be 2 weeks. This is a petri dish. This is a big tester outer, and this is going to be a long time. So I kind of thought, well, I'm a cash clown. I want to, get as cash heavy as possible, just because I didn't know what was going to happen. So I sold my entire set of these toys for a decent chunk of change, way less than they were worth, but just to kind of unload them quickly, just so I could have as much cash on hand, because I didn't know. Mm-hmm. And I weren't going to be able to wrestle. How do I feed my family and stuff like that? So I figured feeding my kid and my critters is more important than having these toys from my childhood. I remember so many dudes messaged me when I sold those things online. They're like, oh no. Like they were all heartbroken that I sold these toys, And way back in the day, I started dabbling and customizing them and like chop shopping them into different dudes and whatever. And then I just got so busy on the road. This was like, 6-7 years ago. And then I hadn't done it for that long. And then, so I had boxes of these like doubles, triples, quadruples, just like beat up ones that I was going to, turn into other toys. And so during the pandemic, so I sold that first batch. Then I went and looked and see what I had left. And I had some, definitely all beaten up ones and nothing of really value. So I just, to kind of take my mind off of what was going on in real life, I just started sort of refurbishing these things and chop shopping them in other dudes. And then people expressed interest in them and liked what I was doing. So I sold a couple. So over this last, 9-10 months or so it's been, 9 months-ish, I sold a handful, which has put a tiny, tiny dent in my lost wrestling revenue. But if nothing else, it helps just distract me from real life. I think when you're this artsy fartsy, like your brain is a freaking hornet's nest. So like I need to dumb down to get any kind of rest. Yeah. Like I can't
hear that.
Be done with my brain. lay down, close my eyes, go to sleep. Like, I need to watch a TV show or a movie or a cartoon or something just to sort of dumb my brain down. So
same.
All the horns that are buzzing around in there kind of get bored, and then eventually I can fall asleep. But so playing with those toys, refurbishing them, you know, chopping them up and doing stuff, you know, making them into other toys is just kind of, it's kind of like a, like an old guy painting little model airplanes or something. It just takes the brain off of real life, I guess. And so there you go. So, I mean, I can show you guys.
Well, I was fortunate enough for my wedding day. I called you. You helped me out. I got myself and my groomsmen a little keepsake. And I here's the Outlandish Zicky Dice one you made me. Look at that. The hair. Look at that. Sinn, yeah, why don't you tell everyone where they can find you? Yeah, let them know where they can find you so they can follow.
All of my social media is the same. It's all Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. It's all Sinn Bodhi, S-I-N-N-B-O-D-H-I. And from there, you can see where I'm doing like webinars, seminars, wrestling shows, merchandise, videos, promos, matches. You can see all that stuff on my social media.
Awesome. I got to thank you so much for joining in, the show and stopping by the Paradise. We have to have you on again. I'm not taking no for an answer.
So. I'm not going to give no for an answer. I'm happy to play with you anytime, my friend.
Love that. The viewers are loving it. My sexy lizards, we got a packed house here. We're on the front page of Twitch. Ladies and gentlemen, hearts in the chat. Help me send off Sinn. Sinn, thank you from the bottom of my fanny pack. I appreciate you being here.
Thank you very much. And all you boys and girls out there in wrestling land and beyond, be safe, be smart, be kind.
Stay outlandish, baby. Don't go anywhere. We've got our promo battle coming up next, and I still got to give you away some merchandise before we get out of here. Sinn has been an incredible guest. I love me some Sinn Bodhi, and definitely got to make sure we go one-on-one here one of these days. Contestant number one. Someone's going to win 250,000 exposure.
Welcome to the Sir Robert Barnum Circus of Madness. I am the mighty, spectacular, less monstrous tamer. And today, I have a message to you, Zicky 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 Dice. I know you are a respected personality in this business. Okay, but I advise you to look yourself into your outlandish paradise. Because I'm coming to tame you. The future of your beloved Twitch will be under a circus tent. Mine. So, ladies and gentlemen, and you, Mr. Zicky Dice, you better remember my name, Sir Robert Barnum.
Dude, Sir Robert Barnum, I'm not going to lie. That is 3 a.m. deep internet vibes, dude. I like it. I got to say, that was pretty good.
Hello, this is El Gato Atomico, the Atomic Cat, here to let you know that I've been hearing everyone talk trash about me lately.
A new one from Gato.
That's okay. Wonder why? Because I am going to bring it. I ain't messing around. This ain't no games. All right? Because you know what? All I got to say is El Gato Atomico is going to beat you. 1, 2, 3. Want to know why? Because that's just how I roll, baby. So you know what? Keep talking all your trash. Keep going all crazy. Keep saying I'm naming names. Because you know what? I ain't naming no names here.
Because you know what? That's good.
El Gato Atomico has got you. Pin 1, 2, 3, baby. You know what? El Gato Atomico is gonna get a little more crazier. He's gonna get sadistic. So you know what? He's gonna be a monster. So let you fly away. Because you know what? 1, 2, 3, baby. El Gato Atomico wins, gets the victory.
All right, I said it last week, and I'll say it again. If we can get to 50 subs in the community, I'm sick and tired of Gato running his mouth every single week. I will wrestle El Gato Itamico live on Twitch. El Gato Itamico wins! Dude, that was close. Shout out to both competitors. That was great. I want to thank you all for joining. Scooch hit our music. I've got to go pick up a light. We got to film. We're going to film something new so we can help make things bigger. Join the Discord, follow on YouTube, follow at Zicky Dice on social media, and of course, follow right here, twitch.tv/Zicky Dice. I want you to have a good Wednesday. Go and watch some wrestling. Go tell a friend what you saw here today. Say, I saw the most outlandish stream on Twitch. You're an amazing show, Andromeda. You are. You get a fanny pack. You get a fanny pack. You get a fanny pack. Thank you, Twitch. Thank you, viewers. Thank you, Lizard. Stay sexy.